Channel 2 and the March of Dimes, expecting the best for your baby.
I've been very fortunate in my life. I've had a wonderful life. I have a lot of great friends. I have the greatest wife.
A full and happy life comes to a tragic end. Michael Landon loses his battle with cancer, but the memory of his accomplishments remains as Entertainment Tonight pays tribute on this first day of July, 1991.
Everyone, sad news to report today. I'm Lisa Gibbons.
And I'm Mary Hart. When Michael Landon learned that he had inoperable cancer in April, he knew the odds were against him. But Landon was determined to put up the best fight he could. Today, he lost that battle. Landon was 54.
I've been a lucky guy. Very lucky guy.
Since his news conference at his Malibu home last April, Michael Landon had been a model patient, fighting his inoperable cancer of the liver and pancreas as best he could and with dignity. Later that same day, he was interviewed by Good Morning America.
And I probably like to get angry, but I really can't. I don't think I've been dealt a very bad hand.
Landon had 9 children, from toddlers to a 42-year-old adopted son. He and third wife Cindy were longtime Malibu residents, and he was a guest on old friend and neighbor Johnny Carson's Tonight Show in May.
And Michael, I think you probably know by now how many millions of people and how many fans you have rooting for you. And if prayer helps at all, you got the prayers of everybody in the nation.
Come back and join us.
Despite tabloid headlines, which Landon publicly denounced for their lack of truthfulness and taste, the actor did cooperate with Life magazine for an unusually candid interview. Life editor Brad Dara was overwhelmed by Landon's honesty and courage.
Tears came to his eyes. Then he explained that he was crying, not out of sorrow for himself, but out of love for the people that he cared about.
Thousands and thousands of letters and cards poured in for the man who spent almost 30 seasons on primetime television, while medical experts did everything they could for the ailing star. Through the entire ordeal, Michael Landon's high spirits were inspiring to fans and friends everywhere.
I've had a wonderful life. I have a lot of great friends. I have the greatest wife. Best kids. In every one of them.
In one episode of his series, Highway to Heaven, Landon featured children who had cancer. 2 months ago, some of those children got together to thank Landon for the inspiration he had given them. It's one aspect of a legacy of help and concern that marked his career.
Anyone who ever sat in front of a television set knows Michael Landon and his diverse accomplishments. Landon's career dates back to the 50s, and his popularity was both instant and long-lived. After 5 seasons as an angel on Highway to Heaven, 8 seasons as Patriarch Charles Ingalls on Little House on the Prairie, and 14 seasons as the youngest Cartwright on Bonanza, Michael Landon became one of the most popular and one of the most successful TV stars in all of television history. The son of a Jewish father and Catholic mother, Landon was quite frank in discussing his unhappiness as the child of 2 incompatible parents. He depicted his upbringing in the 1984 TV movie, Samson.
All you care about is going to the movies.
Nothing wrong with liking the movies.
There is if you think you're going to be in them.
Early success as a javelin thrower led him to USC, and an injury led him to a screen test.
I never thought I was going to make it. I figured I'd throw the javelin in college 4 years, and then I'd go in the service, and hopefully I'd get in the Olympics, and then I'd decide after 8 years what I was going to do. Mm-hmm. But I never felt I was going to make it as an actor because to me, actors were tall and handsome and with great voices.
Help me, doctor, please!
Landon eked out a living in tiny film roles and leading parts in campy pictures like I Was a Teenage Werewolf. When he landed the role of Little Joe in Bonanza in 1959, one of TV's longest-running westerns, Landon's stardom began.
Joseph. Yeah. Whose horse is that outside?
Oh,
horse.
Oh!
Just belongs to a friend of mine, came back with me.
Oh. Girl.
He was the one receiving the fatherly advice from Lauren Green, chasing the beautiful women and quick with his fists.
I was an insecure guy. I mean, all of a sudden I was a big star, and that's tough to handle because you don't know why. So therefore, when you're insecure and you're a star and don't know why, you tend to strike out and act like you think a star should act. And if you have any brains, you outgrow it.
Landon really came into his own when he produced and starred in Little House on the Prairie, based on the classic children's books. He also frequently wrote and directed episodes of this heartwarming family show.
Have you had lunch?
Uh-uh.
Me neither. How about if I make us a picnic and we go fishing?
Yeah, that sounds good, Laura.
Half pint to you, Pa.
Sounds good, half pint.
Highway to Heaven blended a spiritual theme of goodwill into a weekly entertainment series, and Landon and sidekick Victor French explored many noteworthy topics: the environment, international weapons trading, negative campaigning, and literacy.
We try to do as many shows as we can to encourage people to get off their butt, to read a book, to participate. Because it's an obligation when you make your living in this business to be that way.
He had fun in one episode spoofing Werewolf.
Johnson?
Landon returned again and again to one special subject in Highway to Heaven.
I'm going
to
march you all back, and I'm going to put you all in your separate lanes, all right?
The disadvantaged and less fortunate were always welcome in a Landon series. Having dealt extensively with blindness on Little House, he turned to young cancer patients and the handicapped on Highway to Heaven.
Come on, I'm not like everybody else.
Oh, really? That's funny. I thought that's what you were trying to prove. But you were just like everybody else.
Michael Landon was famous within Hollywood for his loyalty toward production crew members and their loyalty to him. Some members of his staff had worked with him on various projects for over a quarter century.
Everybody here is treated with respect regardless of what their job is, because they're very good at what their job is. And just because they're not paid as much as somebody else doesn't make them any less important as people.
In recent years, Landon hosted the American Dream Contest, in which youngsters worldwide got to film their fantasies, and made a TV movie starring Art Carney called Where Pigeons Go to Die, in which he took a small role himself. But it's as a Hollywood mover and shaker that Michael Landon will be best remembered.
What are you worried about, little brother? You ain't never had no trouble outrunning her.
He grew up before us as an actor, even more so as the creator of some very worthwhile television, and more than anything else, as a man of conviction and courage, a real star in the best sense of the word.
I've been a very, very lucky person in this business. I mean, if anybody would have ever told me when I was growing up that anything like this ever would have happened, I would never have believed it in a minute. No way.
Michael Landon once said he wanted people to laugh and cry, not just sit and stare at the TV. He thought viewers were hungry for shows with meaning and always tried to deliver them. Michael Landon, gone at the age of 54.
Loving care means never go gray. Wash it away. We're saying never, just soft and shy.
Free love. Michael Landon lived most of his life in the public eye, and as Jim Brown reminds us this morning, the actor always stayed in character right through to the curtain call.
Michael Landon received a standing ovation on what turned out to be his final public appearance. It was on his good friend Johnny Carson's Tonight program, May 9th. Landon was both serious and humorous about his cancer and its treatment.
Humor is not bad. Humor's bad, but now somebody, I don't want to bring up something that's insensitive, but it was in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
About coffee.
Oh, coffee
you were
enemas.
Your coffee and it didn't.
Oh, I take coffee enemas. Anybody out there ever heard of a coffee enema?
Yes, I've heard of it.
Huh, you must be fun to have breakfast with.
Yes.
But on a more serious note, Landon, who had held a news conference on April 8th to talk openly about his condition, castigated the supermarket tabloids for their treatment of his problem, describing the publications as the real cancer on our society.
It seems so totally insensitive to me, especially since, how do they know what my little kids have been told in my own home that a tabloid would write 4 weeks left or it's over. Can you imagine that?
Michael Landon also provided a look at what turned out to be his final film work, taken from his new TV series that was to begin on network television next season.
You know what, Dad? In my dreams, my kid loved me. Just the same as I love him and his mom.
Michael Landon was still known by many of his old friends as Eugene Orowitz when he first appeared on movie screens in 1957's I Was a Teenage Werewolf. It was a curious mixture of the then popular teenage movie and the horror genre. But Michael Landon was off and running.
Do you look back on a film like that and maybe cringe a little when
I loved it. I have a tape of it. I run it all the time. I think it's a good movie. I like it. My kids like it. They better like it. Their dad's in it.
That means the Landon kids must have watched a lot of television, because the next thing their dad was in lasted for over 13 years.
Lauren and Dan, God bless them, were absolutely the two most terrific guys to do a series with over 14 years. I love those years. They were great.
Can we go in now?
Not just yet.
Charles! We've all been in the house 100 times.
But not today. Today's special.
Then came the 9-year run of Little House on the Prairie that had Landon's stamp of family all over it. He developed the show from the Laura Ingalls Wilder books, was the executive producer, the star, frequently the writer, and more often than not, the director. Filmed in Southern California's Simi Valley, the show lasted until 1982. 2 years later, Landon debuted Highway to Heaven, which lasted some 5 seasons, and in which he played the angelic drifter, Jonathan Smith. Landon gave television solid and uplifting stories of triumph over adversity. One episode, A Song for Jason, ironically was about kids with cancer. Landon used real-life youngsters facing the cancer ordeal. I remember Landon's comments at the time.
Well, the important thing is you don't deal with them any differently than you would anybody else. I mean, that's all handicapped kids and adults and everybody else asks for. I think if you know that every moment is precious, you tend to use every moment.
Of all the stories I did with Michael Landon over the years, I think the finale of Little House was the most dramatic and most emotional for everyone involved. Landon's film company was obligated to restore the land where Little House was shot to its original state. So he wrote a script that required the destruction of all the buildings of Walnut Grove. Landon's co-stars, Kara Grassley and Melissa Gilbert, were referring to the emotions of that day, but with the news of Landon's death, their words have a haunting ring.
I guess you take advantage of what you have. You take for granted the things that you have, and like I say, you don't realize what you have until it's gone.
You know, I think it's just healthy this mourning period, though. I mean, we're going through a true loss, and it's good to experience it. And I myself stayed up very late crying last night.
And Michael Landon was caught up in the emotion when I asked him about the impact of the moment.
You know, I think you can liken it to people who've lived in a house for 10 years and laughed and loved. Blow it up.
I've been a lucky guy. Very lucky guy. And I know I'm in your prayers. I'll do the best I can. You know, live every minute, guys.
This is Today on NBC.
$1,000 and more during our sales extravaganza. Cartwright Dodge Friendswood X.
It's a fast world. I like to change my mind. Give me choices, but don't waste my time.
This week, pick up a 12-pack of Bud, Bud Light, or Bud Dry in 12-ounce cans for only $6.49. Take your pick of 32-ounce fresh and delicious fountain drinks for just 49 cents each. Or get a great deal on 12 packs of Miller, Miller Lite, Genuine Draft, or Genuine Draft Lite in 12-ounce cans for just $6.49.
See everybody. Big house today. Big lineup we've got.
Yes, we're so hot.
Yeah, absolutely. You know who's here? One of my favorite radio guys.
Did
you?
Paul Harvey.
Did you see him out of the
hall? That's why I'm a little late. I hung up with Paul.
Oh, he's absolutely sensational. But nobody does Paul Harvey like me. Are you ready? Hello, Americans. Wait, no, that's not it. But my favorite is the sign-off. And that pregnant pause. Two pregnancies is as long as this pause is. The sign-off.
Okay.
Paul Harvey.
This is...
Good day. Dynamite. Dynamite, right?
We could learn a thing or two from
He's the best. He's the best. He's been around forever. Remember listening to him when I was at Notre Dame, you know, in college.
Yeah, he's an American institution.
He really is.
Did you see the list of awards this man has
won? He's won every award.
This is the only man who's ever won Mother of the Year award. won everything.
He's won everything. See, that's what I need. I need an award. You know, I can't get an award. Listen to me.
A lot of things you need, Reed.
Tell me about it. Just let me read from his book, all right? This is his book, For What It's Worth.
Yes.
Now I'm going to read it like Paul Harvey. Our For What It's Worth department reads the San Diego Union survey of high school students. The survey asked, do you approve advertising condoms on television? 66% of the students polled replied they favored the idea. 26 were opposed to advertising condoms on television. 8% replied that regardless of the ads, President Reagan should continue to send them military aid. For what it's worth.
It's funny.
I'm telling you, his radio cast, Tom Batiste and I were laying on the beach at Nantucket, and Lonnie came on the radio.
He was starting to talk, Reach.
Riveting. Anyway, the whole book is about that particular part of his newscast, For What It's Worth department. So we'll talk to Paul in just a few minutes. But the
looking
big,
forward to that. But this is...
the big story of the day.
You know, we talked about it yesterday, that he was bedridden. You're
the one who brought it up.
Well, it said that in USA Today.
Oh, yeah?
You know, once a person can't get out of bed...
He was bedridden at that point, yeah. Anyway, the big story, of course, Michael Landon's death, and everybody loved this guy and feels a lot poorer because he's gone.
I think he might have been the very first crush I ever had. You know, when he was Little Joe, Bonanza.
Sure,
once you loved him, you were in love with him forever.
He was a few guys, and one of the few guys in Hollywood with enough guts to go after the family entertainment market, which has become something that everybody stays away from because they're afraid they can't get ratings with it. But he did it with three shows.
The only person who rivaled him, apparently, in terms of how many years he was doing quality television, 30 years of it, was Lucille Ball.
That's right. Yeah, 30 years.
What a legacy he's left.
Too bad. A tremendous loss. And incidentally, on our show today, we're going to play one of his segments that he did with us on our show a few years ago. How long ago was that, 1989. You know, he incidentally was a great television talk show guest.
He sure was.
Always had a terrific anecdote story. Yeah. Just wonderful. So we're going to replay that segment in which he tells a classic story as only he could tell it on television.
You know, I think maybe the best legacy he left, Reach, is all the people that worked for him adored him. Mm-hmm. All the technicians.
Yeah.
He even ended up marrying a makeup artist. I mean, they were all, he cared so much about his crews and about the people that worked with him.
9 children.
He cared about them, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, God bless them. And they're little kids, a couple of them.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. Well, anyway, we'll miss you, Michael. Dynamite guy.
Well, now he's in heaven. He's been leading us all to heaven all those years.
Yeah, that's right.
Highway to heaven.
Now he really is an angel.
He's there, yeah.
Well, let me tell you the big thing in my house. We got Ashley the cat shaved.
Now, you just asked the other day Warren Eckstein if you should do that, and he said no.
Why? He's a big Himalayan. I mean, he looked big until we got him shaved.
Now he looks like a rat.
He looks like a rat. I'm calling him... My nickname for him is Rat Cat. That's exactly... He looks like a rat that's just been dragged out of the swamp.
Rat.
Oh, yeah. Very thin, and he's not the same, you know, and the other cat is hissing at him. It's like a gang fight in my house between these two cats.
Oh,
the cat doesn't recognize him without his hair. So you know what I did? I got the other one shaved today. I took...
You have the two ugliest cats in America now.
I took Scarlett in to get her shave. Oh, it really is something. I swear, I wish I could... I may bring Ashley tomorrow on the show. It's really funny.
Oh,
really?
Humor at your cat's expense, do
it. You like that, huh?
Flies, yeah.
So, what else we got cooking today?
Well, Reach, I might be a little late tomorrow morning, so I want you to start without me.
Okay, that means, Reach, ask her why. Why are you going to be late?
No, it's nothing. It's the dynamite singer, Johnny Gill. He is very hot.
All right, we've been talking about Paul Harvey all day now. Here's his new book. It's called For What It's Worth. Incidentally, on the bestseller list, his other three books have been bestsellers as well. He's the most recognized voice on radio. He has 22 million listeners around the country. I think over 1,300 radio stations in America, 400 more around the world. Dynamite newscast, you know, brilliantly edited, expertly delivered. He's just a terrific guy. And it's a pleasure to have him on our show. And here's Mr. Paul Harvey. Hi, Paul. Oh, how are you?
My dear Kathy.
Yes. Have a seat, Paul.
Have you forgiven me?
Why?
We're trying to get you to do my makeup.
Oh, no. That was okay. I walked in this morning in the makeup room, and Paul said, hi, Josephine. And he thought I was going to do his makeup.
Good, Paul. I like that.
I'd be happy to do that.
Now, guess who put Paul up to that? Just kidding. Paul, it's nice to have you here on the show.
Thank you, Regis.
And I guess everybody's been listening to you for most of their lives, you know. How many years have you been on the radio?
Oh, Regis, I'm going to let you figure it out, but I started at 14. I've never really had an honest job.
Really? At the age of 14? You started hanging around a radio station as a kid, right?
Exactly.
Picking up everything?
Finally, they had to put me on the payroll in order to limit my hours.
And you're from Tulsa, Oklahoma to begin with?
Yes, I was interested in hearing from Paula from Oklahoma earlier in this visit.
Sure.
Very intelligent young lady.
You like that, huh? Paul, tell me about your day. Now, how many radio casts do you have a day now?
Well, let's see, three a day.
Three a day.
Morning, noon, news, and the rest of the story later in the day.
Okay. Now, the morning and the afternoon and the noon newscasts are different, right?
Oh, yes. Yes. My work day is rather like yours, I guess. I'm sure, Kathy Lee, you know what it's like. Having a little one get you up even before you have to get down here. So I start at 3:30 in the morning, Chicago time. On the West Coast, 1:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
There's nobody abroad but bakery drivers and bad girls and Paul Harvey.
Good company.
So you're up at 3:30 working, huh? Putting together the first newscast.
Yes.
And what do you use? I mean, I hear...
The wires?
Yes. I mean, I hear stuff on your radio show that I don't hear anywhere else.
Oh, thank you, Regis. But I have a newspaper column at about 300 newspapers. And over the years, those city desks have learned that Paul Harvey likes to, well, as the book suggests, salt and pepper and splash a little sugar on the news to make the hard, cold facts a little bit more palatable.
Yeah.
And they funnel these stories by telephone, by telegraph, by fax now.
Mm.
And that, of course...
That helps.
Oh, my. I owe the books and the broadcasts, everything else to those listeners.
So you got this whole gang of stringers here helping you every day. That's wonderful to have.
They must love being a part of it, the whole process.
I think if someday credit has to be given for Paul Harvey News, it's going to have to be given to a nameless, faceless somebody out there who
contributes.
Inspired.
Sure.
Yeah, I didn't know that it was such a family affair. Your work, your wife and your son work with you.
Oh yes. Since day one, Angel has handled all of our business affairs. Young Paul writes the rest of the stories.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a nice combination.
No. And you just celebrated your 51st wedding anniversary?
Ooh. But now, let me tell you, that's right.
It's quite a love story.
It's a great love story. It's a great story, Paul.
It really is, but I don't know why this embarrasses Angel. For many years, she kept subtracting from the years we've been married. Until one day, she realized our son had become illegitimate, and she had to start going around in the other direction.
But let me tell you how Paul Harvey moved in on his
boy, Angel.
Uh-oh.
I think she was working around the radio station, too. You noticed her. I don't know if she noticed you or not, but then you said, how about dinner? On their first date, at dinner, the man proposed.
Thank you.
That's the rest of the story.
Thank you, Dana Carvey.
I fell into Dana Carvey.
Oh, and you must have...
if you were to meet her, you'd know why.
You were really smitten, huh?
Yes. Now, Angel says that I proposed to all girls on the first date. But that isn't really true.
The first one that said yes. She has an awful lot of degrees. I mean, she has been a student, it sounds like, half of her life also.
I married an education, Kathy Lee. It's been real convenient.
Oh, yeah. That's great.
And she has that Phi Beta Kappa key, which a beautiful blonde is wise enough to wear in her shoe where it doesn't show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Paul, we've got a pause. We'll come right back with more of Paul Harvey. Hello, Americans.
Tomorrow on Live from In Living Color, the hilarious Tommy Davidson.
There are ways to tell if Crystal is high quality and ways to tell if a hot dog is. One is if it plumps. Ballpark Beef Franks do. Always made with fresh, lean, 100% beef. Ballpark, the standard by which all hot dogs should be judged.
Need a smaller upright for a small place? Get a Dirt Devil broom vac. Want a second vac?
Takes a good bite out of life, huh?
I've thought that maybe if I could experience a little bit of everything, I could discuss it more intelligently on the air. At least that's my rationale.
Give me a quick capsule opinion. What do you think of the president's choice of Carl Thomas for the Supreme Court?
Too soon. I don't know the man.
Okay.
I would be inclined, however, to believe that this has been a very studied judgment on the part of the president.
Mm-hmm.
And that I would be inclined to trust. But we'll have to see how he comes out before the Senate committee.
You can do some homework on it.
And what are we going to do about Saddam Hussein?
Or Saddam, as the president
likes. I grew up with an old-fashioned philosophy that there's only one conceivable excuse for getting into a war, and that's to win it. I have never been able to understand pulled-punches wars, where we send our best sons and less than our best weapons into a foreign conflict. I would like, as I think the generals in charge would have liked, to have seen this thing resolved neatly and completely.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, Paul. It's a problem that just won't go away. Okay, now let's get busy, okay? Now why don't you close your eyes and pretend you're listening to the radio. Now, Paul, as you do it on the radio, please, for me, okay?
All right.
I want you to read one of your favorite passages from...
Worth 1, 2, 3, 1 billion, 2 billion, 3 billion, all right.
Yes, okay.
This is my favorite. This is page 33. Now, again, please understand, this is not news. This is a little device that I've used to make hard news a little more palatable, as indeed Kathy Lee and Regis do so very, very well. For what it's worth, Police Chief Clifton Sullivan, Russell Springs, Kentucky, got a call from a lady who wanted her bachelor neighbor arrested for indecent exposure. The chief went to her house, and he witnessed for himself the fact that the man next door was, in fact, in his bathroom, shaving. But the chief said, "Madam, with the bottom half of the man's bathroom window covered as it is, I can't tell whether the bottom part of the man is wearing anything or not." And the woman said, "Well," she said, "you just stand on this chair and stand on your tiptoes and you'll see."
Oh, that's wonderful.
My mother was at it again.
That's right. Paul, a pleasure having you here. You take care of yourself, okay? Because you really are broadcasting out a national treasure.
Thanks so much, dearie.
For being here.
Both of you have a very happy trip.
Thanks, Paul.
See you in a few miles.
Okay. Paul Harvey.
Yes.
Good
day.
We'll be back with Johnny Gill in a moment. Interview with Michael.
I wish I looked that good.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
How are you, big guy?
Mine's medium ash brown. I don't know.
You guys?
Girls, you got to see me when I have my roots done. It's incredible. You wear the little tinfoil bags.
Big award today.
Yeah.
Big one.
That's right.
And prestigious company you're in there.
I know. Yeah, I'm very
honored. Were talking earlier that we don't think you've ever been out of work in your career. Maybe a year or two in between those series. But my gosh, Bonanza ran how many years?
14.
And the next one?
Was 9 for Little House.
Little House was 9 and still in reruns, of course, as is Bonanza, I'm sure.
Right.
And now this one was?
5.
5. Just dynamite.
Winding down, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think that is? Why is it that every series you're associated with has a long run?
I think a lot of it has to do with probably picking the right material, first of all, and a great deal of it has to do with luck. You have to get the right time slot.
Mm-hmm. You got to have your finger on the pulse, though, of America, what the people want to see.
Well, I think that has a lot to do with it. People tend to think it's just New York and
LA.
Los Angeles, and there's a lot more to this country than
it
that.
Sure is.
Because the ideas that I've had for series have never been ones that that the networks generally embraced immediately.
You had to go and really sell and pitch them, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the last one was the eyeballs went to the ceiling.
The guy said, highway to heaven?
I'm going to play an angel. You know, they didn't want to talk to me. Come on.
Well, that's where the prestige helped. You were able to make it happen anyway.
You got it through, and it worked out fine. But let's go back to the beginnings.
Of course.
All right, here we are. Now, you've seen this picture over and over again. I was a teenage werewolf. This was the beginning of it all, 32 years ago. You know, you look a lot like James Dean in this picture.
I won an award for that, as a matter of fact.
Did you really?
From the, from the SBCA.
You old W. Oh, and then, of course, I mean, come on, one more time. Let's just look at this and enjoy this family.
Every woman
there
in America loved Little Joe.
Now, then came Little House on the Prairie. How my kids loved this series.
How
as a matter of fact,
did.
They still watch the reruns. Which one is Melissa Gilbert here? Melissa Gilbert.
She's right there.
She's living here in New York now and appearing on the
just
show.
Just had a baby.
What happened to the other kids?
Your grandfather.
Melissa Sue Anderson is doing a movie right now with Elliot Gould.
She's the tiny one?
No, right here.
Oh, that one. The big one, yeah.
The older.
And the smaller one?
The smaller one is actually two. There were two of those.
Oh, I see.
They always use twins, right?
Because they always use twins when kids are little because you've only got them for a couple hours a day.
And the missus on the prairie?
I haven't seen Karen since the show folded.
Do people know that Michael Landon has 9 children?
Yeah.
And a grandchild.
A couple.
You have a couple now?
Yeah. Yeah. 2 grandkids, 1 more on the way.
But some of the
my wife just filled a void in my life. She got her 7th dog.
7 dogs at home together?
7 dogs.
Are they all different types?
Oh, yeah. They only have one thing in common.
They eat.
No, they all go in the house.
Well, it's not the prairie.
Every time
you know?
You bring a new dog in, you've got to train the dog.
Well, you know.
And if that dog goes in your house, all the other dogs that you've trained say, okay.
Let's hit that road, fellas. It's party time.
True.
You told the most classic story on the Last Tonight Show appearance. Incidentally, you're great with Johnny.
We have a good time.
Good time. And you told this story. It was absolutely a spellbinder. The guy next door.
Oh, well, that's a true story. It did not happen to me.
I wanted to ask you if that was a true story.
Yeah, it's a true story. It didn't happen to me, but that was true.
Michael, could we tell that story one more time?
I'll tell it very quickly. And when I did it to John, I pretended like it had actually happened. But what happened was the next door neighbors to this particular family, very, very close. They're very dear friends. They both had 2 kids. The one family had a nice big dog, and the other family had 1 pet, and it was a rabbit. Well, the family went away for a weekend, the family that owned the rabbit. They went skiing. And on a Saturday morning, the man who owned the dog came out of the house to get the paper, and his dog was standing in front of the house with a rabbit in his mouth. It was dead. Well, a guy panics. He brings the dog in the house. The family is in shock. They don't want to. Here's their best friends. This was the animal that other family loved. He said, we cannot tell them. We can't tell them. They'll hate us for the rest of our lives. Mm-hmm. He took the rabbit in the kitchen, put it in the sink, and washed it. So it was dirt all over. Washed it, blew dry the rabbit.
You love this story, Reed?
Fluffed the hair up.
It's a very touching story.
Brought the rabbit back and put it into the little cage, the little hutch area, and shut the cage door. Now the family comes home late Sunday, and the guy's going to be cool. Have a good trip skiing. Oh, yeah, wonderful. Everything was great. Had some nice spring snow. And he said, but boy, something weird happened when we were gone. He said, oh, yeah? He said, well, you know, our rabbit. Oh, yeah, your rabbit? He said, yeah, it died on Friday, and we buried it. The kids wanted to bury it. He said, we came home, and it was back in the cage.
I love that story. It's a great story. Michael, You're a terrific guy, and may we add our congratulations to a terrific career and all the contributions you've made to our business.
Thank you.
And have a wonderful day today with the New York Women, okay?
I sure will.
Thank you very much. Michael Landon, everybody. One last look at Michael Landon, and as we have said earlier, a tragic loss for all of us, really.
I wonder if he was sick at the time. You know?
Boy, it happened so quickly. I think
Once
that's what staggered everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we all knew what was going on, but...
he always looked so healthy.
Mm.
He never cut his hair because he loved the story of Samson. That's where Samson got his
strength. That's right. As a matter of fact, when he did cut his hair once, he couldn't throw the javelin as far.
That's
Remember
right.
that story?
Yeah.
When he was a young man, and so he never really cut it again. Anyway, we'll be right back in a moment.
I'm trying to call overseas with this other long-distance company. I think I remember the number, but...
Will it not be signed?
I guess not. I call the operator, but she says she can't give me an international number. I say AT&T always could. She says, you're not dealing with AT&T.
If you miss dealing with AT&T, it's easier than ever to come back. Just call 1-800-251-7100 right now, and we'll switch you back for free.
They kept saying how much money I'd save, so I kept waiting for that first low bill. Then I get it. I'm not kidding. I thought it was a typo. I mean, where were the big savings?
People who thought they could do better than AT&T are coming back for the real value. Like the Reach Out America plan where you can...
Channel 2 and the March of Dimes. Expecting the best for your baby.
I've been very fortunate in my life. I've had a wonderful life. I have a lot of great friends. I have the greatest wife.
A full and happy life comes to a tragic end. Michael Landon loses his battle with cancer, but the memory of his accomplishments remains as Entertainment Tonight pays tribute on this first day of July, 1991.
Everyone, sad news to report today. I'm Lisa Gibbons.
And I'm Mary Hart. When Michael Landon learned that he had inoperable cancer in April, he knew the odds were against him. But Landon was determined to put up the best fight he could. Today, he lost that battle. Landon was 54.
I've been a lucky guy. Very lucky guy.
Since his news conference at his Malibu home last April, Michael Landon had been a model patient, fighting his inoperable cancer of the liver and pancreas as best he could and with dignity. Later that same day, he was interviewed by Good Morning America.
And I probably like to get angry, but I really can't. I don't think I've been dealt a very bad hand.
Landon had 9 children, from toddlers to a 42-year-old adopted son. He and third wife Cindy were longtime Malibu residents, and he was a guest on old friend and neighbor Johnny Carson's Tonight Show in May.
And Michael, I think you probably know by now how many millions of people and how many fans you have rooting for you. And if prayer helps at all, you got the prayers of everybody in the nation.
Come back and join us.
Despite tabloid headlines, which Landon publicly denounced for their lack of truthfulness and taste, the actor did cooperate with Life magazine for an unusually candid interview. Life editor Brad Dara was overwhelmed by Landon's honesty and courage.
Tears came to his eyes. Then he explained that he was crying, not out of sorrow for himself, but out of love for the people that he cared about.
Thousands and thousands of letters and cards poured in for the man who spent almost 30 seasons on primetime television, while medical experts did everything they could for the ailing star. Through the entire ordeal, Michael Landon's high spirits were inspiring to fans and friends everywhere.
I've had a wonderful life. I have a lot of great friends. I have the greatest wife. Best kids. In every one of them.
In one episode of his series, Highway to Heaven, Landon featured children who had cancer. 2 months ago, some of those children got together to thank Landon for the inspiration he had given them. It's one aspect of a legacy of help and concern that marked his career.
Anyone who ever sat in front of a television set knows Michael Landon and his diverse accomplishments. Landon's career dates back to the 50s, and his popularity was both instant and long-lived. After five seasons as an angel on Highway to Heaven, eight seasons as patriarch Charles Ingalls on Little House on the Prairie, and 14 seasons as the youngest Cartwright on Bonanza, Michael Landon became one of the most popular and one of the most successful TV stars in all of television history. The son of a Jewish father and Catholic mother, Landon was quite frank in discussing his unhappiness as the child of two incompatible parents. He depicted his upbringing in the 1984 TV movie, Samson.
All you care about is going to the movies.
Nothing wrong with liking the movies.
There is if you think you're going to be in them.
Early success as a javelin thrower led him to USC, and an injury led him to a screen test.
I never thought I was going to make it. I figured I'd throw the javelin in college 4 years, and then I'd go in the service, and hopefully I'd get in the Olympics, and then I'd decide after 8 years what I was going to do. Mm-hmm. But I never felt I was going to make it as an actor, because to me, actors were tall and handsome and with great voices.
Help me, doctor, please!
Landon eked out a living in tiny film roles and leading parts in campy pictures like I Was a Teenage Werewolf. When he landed the role of Little Joe in Bonanza in 1959, one of TV's longest-running westerns, Landon's stardom began.
Joseph? Yeah? Whose horse is that outside?
A horse?
Oh!
Just belongs to a friend of mine, came back with me.
No. Girl.
He was the one receiving the fatherly advice from Lauren Green, chasing the beautiful women and quick with his fists.
I was an insecure guy. I mean, all of a sudden I was a big star, and that's tough to handle because you don't know why. So therefore, when you're insecure and you're a star and don't know why, you tend to strike out and act like you think a star should act. And if you have any brains, you outgrow it.
Landon really came into his own when he produced and starred in Little House on the Prairie, based on the classic children's books. He also frequently wrote and directed episodes of this heartwarming family show.
Have you had lunch?
Uh-uh.
Me neither. How about if I make us a picnic and we go fishing?
Yeah, that sounds good, Laura.
Half pint to you, Pa.
Sounds good, half pint.
Highway to Heaven blended a spiritual theme of goodwill into a weekly entertainment series, and Landon and sidekick Victor French explored many noteworthy topics: the environment, international weapons trading, negative campaigning, and literacy.
We try to do as many shows as we can to encourage people to get off their butt, to read a book, to participate. Because it's an obligation when you make your living in this business to be that way.
He had fun in one episode spoofing werewolf.
Jonathan? Fight in my house between these two cats.
Oh,
the cat doesn't recognize him without his hair. So you know what I did? I got the other one shaved today.
You have the two ugliest cats in America now.
I took Scarlett in to get her shaved. Oh, it really is something. I swear, I wish I could. I may bring Ashley tomorrow on the show. It's really funny.
Oh,
really?
Humor at your cat's expense, do
it. You like that, huh?
Flies, yeah.
So what else we got cooking today?
Well, Reach, I might be a little late tomorrow morning, so I want you to start without me.
Okay, that means, Reach, ask her why. Why are you going to be late?
No, it's nothing. It's the dynamite singer, Johnny Gill. He is very hot.
All right, we've been talking about Paul Harvey all day now. Here's his new book. It's called For What It's Worth. Incidentally, on the bestseller list, his other three books have been bestsellers as well. He's the most recognized voice on radio. He has 22 million listeners around the country. I think over 1,300 radio stations in America, 400 more around the world. Dynamite newscast, you know, brilliantly edited, expertly delivered. He's just a terrific guy, and it's a pleasure to have him on our show. And here's Mr. Paul Harvey.
Good day.
Hi, Paul. Oh, how are you?
My dear Kathy.
Yes. Have a seat, Paul.
Have you forgiven me?
Why?
We're trying to get you to do my makeup.
Oh, no. No, that was okay. I walked in this morning in the makeup room, And Paul said, "Hi, Josephine." And he thought I was going to do his makeup.
Good, Paul. I like that.
I would have been happy to do that.
Now, guess who put Paul up to that? Just kidding. Paul, it's nice to have you here on the show.
Thank you, Regis.
And I guess everybody's been listening to you for most of their lives, you know. How many years have you been on the radio?
Oh, Regis, I'm going to let you figure it out, but I started at 14. I've never really had an honest job.
Really? At the age of 14? You started hanging around a radio station as a kid, right?
Exactly.
Picking up everything?
Finally, they had to put me on the payroll in order to limit my hours.
And you're from Tulsa, Oklahoma to begin with?
Yes, I was interested in hearing from Paula from Oklahoma earlier in this visit.
Sure.
Very intelligent young lady.
You like that, huh? Paul, tell me about your day. Now, how many radio casts do you have a day now?
Well, let's see, three a day.
Three a day.
Morning, noon, news, and the rest of the story later in the day.
Okay. Now, the morning and the afternoon and the noon newscasts are different, right?
Oh, yes. Yes. My work day is rather like yours, I guess. I'm sure, Kathy Lee, you know what it's like, having a little one get you up even before you have to get down here. So I start at 3:30 in the morning, Chicago time. On the West Coast, 1:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
There's nobody abroad but bakery drivers and bad girls and Paul Harvey.
Good company.
So you're up at 3:30 working, huh? Putting together the first newscast.
Yes.
And what do you use? I mean, I hear...
The wires?
Yes. I mean, I hear stuff on your radio show that I don't hear anywhere else.
Oh, thank you, Regis. But I have a newspaper column at about 300 newspapers. And over the years, those city desks have learned that Paul Harvey likes to, well, as the book suggests, salt and pepper and splash a little sugar on the news to make the hard, cold facts a little bit more palatable.
Yeah.
And they funnel these stories by telephone, by telegraph, by fax now.
Mm.
And that, of course...
That helps.
Oh, my. I owe the books and the broadcasts, everything else to those listeners.
So you got this whole gang of stringers here helping you every day. That's wonderful to have.
They must love being a part of it, the whole process.
Mm.
I think if someday credit has to be given for Paul Harvey News, it's going to have to be given to a nameless, faceless somebody out there who keeps
who
me
contributes,
inspired.
Sure.
Yeah, I didn't know that it was such a family affair, your work. Your wife and your son work with you.
Oh, yes, yes. Since day one, Angel has handled all of our business affairs. Young Paul writes the rest of the stories.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a nice combination.
No. And you just celebrated your 51st wedding anniversary?
Ooh. But now, let me tell you, that's right.
It's
a great love story. It's a great story, Paul.
It really is, but I don't know why this embarrasses Angel. For many years, she kept subtracting from the years we've been married. Until one day she realized our son had become illegitimate, and she had to start going around in the other direction.
But let me tell you how Paul Harvey moved in on his
boy.
Angel.
Uh-oh.
I think she was working around the radio station, too. You noticed her. I don't know if she noticed you or not, but then you said, "How about dinner?" On their first date, at dinner, the man proposed.
Thank you.
That's the rest of the story.
Thank you, Dana Carvey.
I fell into Dana Carvey. Then.
Well, if you were to meet her, you'd know why.
You were really smitten, huh?
Yes. Now, Angel says that I proposed to all girls on the first date. But that isn't really true.
The first one said yes. She has an awful lot of degrees. I mean, she has been a student, it sounds like, half of her life also.
I married an education, Kathy Lee. It's been real convenient.
Oh, that's great.
And she has that Phi Beta Kappa key, which a beautiful blonde is wise enough to wear in her shoe where it doesn't show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Paul, we've got a pause. We'll come right back with more. Of Paul Harvey in a moment. Hello, Americans.
Tomorrow on Live from In Living Color, the hilarious Tommy Davidson.
There are ways to tell if Crystal is high quality and ways to tell if a hot dog is. One is if it plumps. Ballpark Beef Franks do. Always made with fresh, lean, 100% beef. Ballpark, the standard by which all hot dogs should be judged.
Need a smaller upright for a small place? Get a Dirt Devil broom vac. Want a second vac?
Takes a good bite out of life, huh?
I've thought that maybe if I could experience a little bit of everything, I could discuss it more intelligently on the air. At least that's my rationale.
Give me a quick capsule opinion. What do you think of the president's choice of Carl Thomas for the Supreme Court?
Too soon. I don't know the man.
Okay.
I would be inclined, however, to...
make it most emotional for everyone involved.
Landon's film company was obligated to restore the land where Little House was shot to its original state. So he wrote a script that required the destruction of all the buildings of Walnut Grove. Landon's co-stars, Kara Grassley and Melissa Gilbert, were referring to the emotions of that day, but with the news of Landon's death, their words have a haunting ring.
I guess you take advantage of what you have. You take for granted the things that you have, and like I say, you don't realize what you have until it's gone.
You know, I think it's just healthy this mourning period, though. I mean, we're going through a true loss, and it's good to experience it. And I myself stayed up very late crying last night.
And Michael Landon was caught up in the emotion when I asked him about the impact of the moment.
You know, I think you can liken it to people who've lived in a house for 10 years and laughed and loved. Blow it up.
I've been a lucky guy. Very lucky guy. And I know I'm in your prayers. I'll do the best I can. You know. Live every minute, guys.
This is Today on NBC.
$1,000 and more during our sales extravaganza. Cartwright Dodge Friends would ex.
It's a fast world. I like to change my mind. Give me choices, but don't waste my time.
This week, pick up a 12-pack of Bud, Bud Light, or Bud Dry in 12-ounce cans for only $6.49. Take your pick of 32-ounce fresh and delicious fountain drinks for just 49 cents each. Or get a great deal on 12 packs of Miller, Miller Lite, Genuine Draft, or Genuine Draft Light in 12-ounce cans for just $6.49.
See everybody, big house today. Big lineup we've got.
Yes, wow. So hot.
Yeah, absolutely. You know who's here? One of my favorite radio guys.
Did
you?
Paul Harvey.
Did you see him out of the
hall? That's why I'm a little late. Got hung up with Paul.
Oh, he's absolutely sensational. But nobody does Paul Harvey like me. Are you ready? Hello, Americans. Wait, no, that's not it. But my favorite is the sign-off. And that pregnant pause. Two pregnancies is as long as this pause is. The sign-off.
Okay.
Paul Harvey.
This is...
Good day. Dynamite. Dynamite, right?
We could learn a thing or two from
He's the best. He's the best. He's been around forever. Remember listening to him when I was at Notre Dame, you know, in college.
Yeah, he's an American institution.
He really is.
Did you see the list of awards this man has
won? He's won every award.
This is the only man who's ever won Mother of the Year award. won everything.
He's won everything. See, that's what I need. I need an award. You know, I can't get an award. Listen to me.
A lot of things you need, Reed.
Tell me about it. Just let me read from his book, all right? This is his book, For What It's Worth.
Yes.
Now I'm going to read it like Paul Harvey. Our For What It's Worth department reads the San Diego Union survey of high school students. The survey asked, do you approve advertising condoms on television? 66% of the students polled replied they favored the idea. 26 were opposed to advertising condoms on television. 8% replied that regardless of the ads, President Reagan should continue to send them military aid. For what it's worth.
It's funny.
I'm telling you, his radio cast, Tom Batiste and I were laying on the beach at Nantucket, and Lonnie came on the radio.
People starting to talk, Reach.
Riveting. Anyway, the whole book is about that particular part of his newscast, For What It's Worth department. So we'll talk to Paul in just a few minutes. But the
looking
big,
forward to that. But this is...
the big story of the day.
You know, we talked about it yesterday, that he was bedridden.
You're the one who brought it up.
Well, it said that in USA Today.
Oh, yeah?
You know, once a person can't get out of bed...
He was bedridden at that point, yeah. Anyway, the big story, of course, Michael Landon's death, and everybody loved this guy and feels a lot poorer because he's gone.
I think he might have been the very first crush I ever had. You know, when he was Little Joe, Bonanza.
Sure,
Once you loved him, you were in love with him forever.
He was a few guys, and one of the few guys in Hollywood with enough guts to go after the family entertainment market, which has become something that everybody stays away from because they're afraid they can't get ratings with it. But he did it with three shows.
The only person who rivaled him, apparently, in terms of how many years he was doing quality television,
30 years of it was Lucille Ball.
That's right. Yeah, 30 years.
What a legacy he's left.
Too bad. A tremendous loss. And incidentally, on our show today, we're going to play one of his segments that he did with us on our show a few years ago. How long ago was that, Kelly? 1989. You know, he incidentally was a great television talk show guest.
He sure was.
Always had a terrific story. Yeah, just wonderful. So we're going to replay that segment in which he tells a classic story as only he could tell it, Don.
You know, I think maybe the best legacy he left, Reach, is all the people that worked for him adored him. Mm-hmm. All the technicians.
Yeah.
He even ended up marrying a makeup artist. I mean, they were all, he cared mm-hmm. so much about his crews and about the people that worked with him.
Nine children.
He cared about them, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, God bless them. And they're little kids, a couple of them.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. Well, anyway, we'll miss you, Michael. Dynamite guy.
Well, now he's in heaven. He's been leading us all to heaven all those years.
Yeah, that's right.
Highway to heaven.
Now he really is an angel.
He's there, yeah.
Well, let me tell you the big thing in my house. We got Ashley the cat shaved.
Now, you just asked the other day Warren Eckstein if you should do that, and he said no.
Why? He's a big Himalayan. I mean, he looked big until we got him shaved.
Now he looks like a rat.
He looks like a rat. I'm calling him my nickname for him is Rat Cat. That's exactly... He looks like a rat that's just been dragged out of the swamp.
Rat.
Oh, yeah. Very thin, and he's not the same, you know, and the other cat is hissing at him. It's like a gang.
You believe that this has been a very studied judgment on the part of the president,
mm-hmm.
and that I would be inclined to trust. But we'll have to see how he comes out before the Senate committee.
You can do some homework on it.
And what are we going to do about Saddam Hussein?
Or Saddam, as the president.
I grew up with an old-fashioned philosophy that there's only one conceivable excuse for getting into a war, and that's to win it. I have never been able to understand pulled-punches wars, where we send our best sons and less than our best weapons into a foreign conflict. I would like, as I think the generals in charge would have liked, to have seen this thing resolved mm-hmm. neatly and completely.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, Paul.
The American public feels that way, too.
It's a problem that just won't go away. Okay, now let's get busy, okay? Now let's, why don't you close your eyes and pretend you're listening to the radio. Now, Paul, as you do it on the radio, please, for me, okay?
All right.
I want you to read one of your favorite passages from...
Worth 1, 2, 3, 1 billion, 2 billion, 3 billion, all right.
Yes, okay.
This is my favorite. This is page 33. Now, again, please understand, this is not news. This is a little device that I've used to make hard news a little more palatable, as indeed Kathy Lee and Regis do so very, very well. For what it's worth, Police Chief Clifton Sullivan, Russell Springs, Kentucky, got a call from a lady who wanted her bachelor neighbor arrested for indecent exposure. The chief went to her house, and he witnessed for himself the fact that the man next door was, in fact, in his bathroom shaving. But the chief said, "Madam, with the bottom half of the man's bathroom window covered as it is, I can't tell whether the bottom part of the man is wearing anything or not." And the woman said, "Well," she said, "you just stand on this chair and stand on your tiptoes and you'll see."
Oh, that's wonderful.
My mother was at it again.
That's right. Paul. A pleasure having you here. You take care of yourself, okay? Because you really are broadcasting out a national treasure.
Thank you so much, dearie.
For being here.
Both of you have a very happy trip.
Thanks, Paul.
See you in a few miles.
Okay. Paul Harvey.
Yeah. Thank
you. Good day. We'll be back with Johnny Gill in a moment. Interview with Michael.
Hey, man. How are you
doing? Good to see you.
I wish I looked that good.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
How are you, big guy?
Mine's medium ash brown. I don't know what you're using.
You guys?
Girls, you got to see me when I have my roots done. It's incredible. You wear the little tinfoil bags.
Big award today.
Yeah.
Big one.
That's right.
And prestigious company you're in there.
I know. Yeah, I'm very
honored. Were talking earlier that we don't think you've ever been out of work in your career. Maybe a year or two in between those series. But my gosh, Bonanza ran how many years?
14.
And the next one?
Was 9 for Little House.
Little House was 9 and still in reruns, of course, as is Bonanza, I'm sure.
Right.
And now this one was?
5.
5. Just dynamite.
Winding down, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think that is? Why is it that every series you're associated with has a long run?
I think a lot of it has to do with probably picking the right material, first of all, and a great deal of it has to do with luck. You have to get the right time slot.
Mm-hmm. You got to have your finger on the pulse, though, of America, what the people want to see.
Well, I think that has a lot to do with it. People tend to think it's just New York and LA. And Los Angeles, and there's a lot more to this country than
there
that.
There sure is.
Because the ideas that I've had for series have never been ones that the networks generally embraced immediately.
You had to go and really sell and pitch them, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the last one was the eyeballs went to the ceiling.
The guy said, highway to heaven?
I'm going to play an angel. You know, they didn't want to talk to me. Come on.
Well, that's where the prestige helped. You were able to make it happen anyway.
You got it through, and it worked out fine. But let's go back to the beginnings.
Of course.
All right, here we are. Now, you've seen this picture over and over again. I was a teenage werewolf. This was the beginning of it all, 32 years ago. You know, you look a lot like James Dean in this picture.
I won an award for that, as a matter of fact.
Did you really?
From the, from the SBCA.
Very excited. Oh, and then, of course, I mean, come on, one more time. Let's just look at this and enjoy this family.
Was it every woman
there
in America in love with Little Joe?
Now, then came Little House on the Prairie. How my kids loved this series.
Oh,
as a matter of fact,
did.
They still watch the reruns. Which one is Melissa Gilbert here? Melissa Gilbert.
She's right there.
She's living here in New York now and appearing on the
just
show.
Just had a baby.
What happened to the other kids?
Your grandfather.
Michael?
Melissa Sue Anderson is doing a movie right now with Elliot Gould.
She's the tiny one?
No, right here.
Oh, that one. The big one, yeah.
The older.
And the smaller one?
The smaller one is actually two. There were two of those.
Oh, I see.
They always use twins, right?
Because they always use twins when kids are little because you've only got them for a couple hours a day.
And the missus on the prairie?
I haven't seen Karen since the show folded.
Do people know that Michael Landon has 9 children?
Yeah.
And a grandchild.
A couple.
You have a couple now?
Yeah. Got 2 grandkids, 1 more on the way.
My wife
just filled a void in my life. She got her 7th dog.
7 dogs at home together?
7 dogs.
Are they all different types?
Oh, yeah. They only have one thing in common.
They eat.
No, they all go in the house.
Well, it's not the prairie.
Every time you bring a new dog in, you've got to train the dog.
Well, you know that.
And if that dog goes in your house, all the other dogs that you've trained say, okay.
Let's hit that road, fellas. It's party time.
True.
You told the most classic story on the Last Tonight Show appearance. Incidentally, you're great with Johnny.
Oh, we have a good time.
Good time. And you told this story. It was absolutely...
Landon returned again and again to one special subject in Highway to Heaven.
I'm going
to
march you all back, and I'm going to put you all in your separate lanes, all right?
The disadvantaged and less fortunate were always welcome in a Landon series. Having dealt extensively with blindness on Little House, he turned to young cancer patients and the handicapped on Highway to Heaven.
Come on, I'm not like everybody else.
Oh, really? That's funny. I thought that's what you were trying to prove. But you were just like everybody else.
Michael Landon was famous within Hollywood for his loyalty toward production crew members and their loyalty to him. Some members of his staff had worked with him on various projects for over a quarter century.
Everybody here is treated with respect regardless of what their job is, because they're very good at what their job is. And just because they're not paid as much as somebody else doesn't make them any less important as people.
In recent years, Landon hosted the American Dream Contest, in which youngsters worldwide got to film their fantasies, and made a TV movie starring Art Carney called Where Pigeons Go to Die, in which he took a small role himself. But it's as a Hollywood mover and shaker that Michael Landon will be best remembered.
What are you worried about, little brother? You ain't never had no trouble outrunning her.
He grew up before us as an actor, even more so as the creator of some very worthwhile television. And more than anything else, as a man of conviction and courage, a real star in the best sense of the word.
I've been a very, very lucky person in this business. I mean, if anybody would have ever told me when I was growing up that anything like this ever would have happened, I would never have believed it in a minute. No way.
Michael Landon once said he wanted people to laugh and cry, not just sit and stare at the TV. He He thought viewers were hungry for shows with meaning and always tried to deliver them. Michael Landon, gone at the age of 54.
Loving care means never go gray. Wash it away. We're saying never to soft and shock.
Free love. Michael Landon lived most of his life in the public eye, and as Jim Brown reminds us this morning, the actor always stayed in character right through to the curtain call.
Michael Landon received a standing ovation on what turned out to be his final public appearance. It was on his good friend Johnny Carson's Tonight program, May 9th. Landon was both serious and humorous about his cancer and its treatment.
Humor is not bad. Humor's bad, but now somebody, I don't want to bring up something that's insensitive, but it was in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
About coffee.
Oh, coffee
enemas.
You're
taking your coffee and it didn't.
Oh, I take coffee enemas. Anybody out there ever heard of a coffee enema?
Yes, I've heard of it.
Huh, you must be fun to have breakfast with.
Yes.
But on a more serious note, Landon, who had held a news conference on April 8th to talk openly about his condition, castigated the supermarket tabloids for their treatment of his problem, describing the publications as the real cancer on our society.
It seems so totally insensitive to me, especially since, how do they know what my little kids have been told in my own home, that a tabloid would write 4 weeks left, or it's over. Can you imagine that?
Michael Landon also provided a look at what turned out to be his final film work, taken from his new TV series that was to begin on network television next season.
You know what, Dad? In my dreams, my kid loved me. Just the same as I love him and his mom.
Michael Landon was still known by many of his old friends as Eugene Orowitz when he first appeared on movie screens in 1957's I Was a Teenage Werewolf. It was a curious mixture of the then-popular teenage movie and the horror genre. But Michael Landon was off and running.
Do you look back on a film like that and maybe cringe a little when
I loved it. I have a tape of it. I run it all the time. I think it's a good movie. I like it. My kids like it. They better like it. Their dad's in it.
That means the Landon kids must have watched a lot of television, because the next thing their dad was in lasted for over 13 years.
Lauren and Dan, God bless them, were absolutely the two most terrific guys to do a series with over 14 years. I love those years. They were great.
Can we go in now?
Not just yet.
Charles! We've all been in the house 100 times.
But not today. Today's special.
Then came the 9-year run of Little House on the Prairie that had Landon's stamp of family all over it. He developed the show from the Laura Ingalls Wilder books, was the executive producer, the star, frequently the writer, and more often than not, the director. Filmed in Southern California's Simi Valley, the show lasted until 1982. 2 years later, Landon debuted Highway to Heaven, which lasted some 5 seasons, and in which he played the angelic drifter Jonathan Smith. Landon gave television solid and uplifting stories of triumph over adversity. One episode, A Song for Jason, ironically was about kids with cancer. Landon used real-life youngsters facing the cancer ordeal. I remember Landon's comments at the time.
Well, the important thing is you don't deal with them any differently than you would anybody else. I mean, that's all handicapped kids and adults and everybody else asks for. I think if you know that that every moment is precious, you tend to use every moment.
Of all the stories I did with Michael Landon over the years, I think the finale of Little House was the most dramatic.